in Oakland, the difference between life and death is as transparent as ghosts on the streets.
Police responded to a shooting here on Oscar Avenue. They found Philip Wright lying on the floor of his own residence, shot dead after answering a knock at the front door.
For some, life is lived moment to moment,
breath to breath.
Lost the guns and bullet shell.
On November 19th, Philip Wright,
my friend
and my brother,
was violently murdered at his doorstep.
Unaware, unknowing that his last day. Even now that you're dead,
in my nightmare,
I can picture the red blood that was shed. You bleed, so I bled.
Your innocence soaked like a crimson river over these concrete streets of the city. I can only imagine his last thoughts. Fear and memories of a short life. No one deserves to die. Philip did not deserve to die.
I will always look to the sky and try to find the exact spot where the stars end and the heavens begin.
Wait for me there, my friend.
Wait for me.
Remember him moving in to the house that he used to live at.
Okay, so I knew Philip like when we were babies.
I met Philip with Tyrion all of them together.
Me and Philip have been boys since fourth grade. I met Philip on the playground.
I met Philip the week after I met Tyrion. I started hanging out with him.
And he would see us outside, and because his brothers are so older than him, he can't really play tag with us. So he would come outside and play tag with us.
And ever since then, we was just like, We was friends ever since then.
But yeah, I looked at Philip kind of like a little brother because I knew he looked up to me. I knew he did.
We used to just kick it outside in the summertime all the time. Like me, him, Terry, Peter, Jabari, Anthony, and Jamal.
That was my brother. Like I'd take him anywhere. I don't care.
It was Thursday.
So we were kind of like getting him out the house and getting him away from all that. So we invited him to come with us to a party that was happening at our school.
Me and Javari were already up there because I was paying for Phillip's dance ticket.
Me and Terry were actually on the way to come pick him up to go to the ball. He was supposed to come with us. Terry was on the phone with him.
Get to the railroad. I'm hearing sirens. I'm used to it. And then I get there. When I'm looking down, there's this woman in the car crying on the phone. And that's the first thing I noticed before I noticed anything else. I see her on the phone crying. And she looks so familiar. She looks so familiar. She turned out to be one of Phillip's aunts.
We do. We get out. We walk under the tape.
I see a grandma. I walk over and I give her a hug. And then she started holding me. She was shaking, and that's when I started crying.
We had heard many stories. We heard that he had got shot and he had died. We heard that he was in an ambulance and he was in the hospital.
Like, we gonna go to the hospital or whatever. So, and the whole time we getting calls from like his cousin and Terry, and they telling us like, he alive, he kicking.
And Mr. Terry told me, I was like, dude, he was like, it don't look good.
And they called him, like, Philip's gone.
Devastating, like losing brother.
I felt like it wasn't fair.
Right, he beat my chest when I heard that. It was like, sat on the ground, and started crying.
Like, you don't really know how important something is until you lose it.
Philip wasn't in the games, and like, in the violence, and he was a good kid, like.
Yeah, as far as she's on the hide and seek in the dark. We all mess with Philip. Everybody used to jump on Philip and wrestle with him.
I could go in there and then we could wrestle or we could fight with the pillows. It'd be me and him versus his older brother or something like that.
Philip had the biggest crush on like his neighbor. She wasn't interested in him, but like Philip being the person he would like never give up. Every day he would come outside and, hi Michelle. And she would like, no. I don't know what Philip was doing. I think he just came from swimming how ashy he was. Elbows ashy, white waving, just white elbows waving like, hi Michelle. And she like, you gonna take your ashy and go put on some lotion? Put on lotion, came back outside and waved again. That's when like that perseverance.
He was turning it all around. He had been working here for a while. And like he was doing like everything good. Like he was becoming like a positive role model.
Doing water conservation in the middle of East Oakland, like, who does that? Like, who can you say does that?
He started, like, feeling, like, a lot of hope, like, come out of college. You know what I mean? Like, getting out of Oakland, all this. It was,
a rose that grew from concrete. Phil, to me, Phil was like that rose. And he was just blossoming. When his life got taken away, it was like he never really got the chance to really bloom and show his full potential. To show that even though I'm coming from this bad situation, I'm in this bad environment, I can still make it. And I can still shine.
I see you soon. I see you one day.
Time it was, and what a time it was, it was. A time of innocence. A time of confidences. Long ago it must be, I have a photograph. Preserve your memories, they're all that's left you.
My name is Javar Gaines. I am a senior star here at ELVA. I've been attending ELVA for 7 to 8 years.
My name is Terry Mullane Jr. I'm the head intern at the East Oakland Boxing Association Smart Moves program. I've been coming here for 10 years. First started the program when I was 7 years old, and now I'm 17.
My full name is Jamal Naeem Shifrin, and my position is senior intern. I'm a senior intern. With the gym for about 4 years since my ninth grade year. I was introduced to my ninth grade.
My emotions on the last day of school, or in that week, was it was like I took off the 85 pound battle armor. Just, you know, go to the beach.
It was hard to get some sleep, because you know the next day of graduation day, you never felt that 12th grade graduation before, so it was an exciting feeling.
The people, the relationships that I built with the people there, not only the students, but the faculty also. At Envision, we got to call our teachers by their first names, so it was kind of good, it was kind of bad, but it was more of a personal atmosphere than just like work. Like, you go there and then you sit down. It was like, so John, you know, John Kittredge, how was your day? How's the life? How's the wife? How's the family? How's the kids? And all of this and all that. So I miss being able to do that. And those people being able to interact with them.
I'm gonna miss these people more because it's a good and whole, like, good family environment there. You know, everybody knows me. It's like one of the most popular guys in school. So it was like, I really loved it. It's like a second family.
It's high school, and like that time of, like, this is the time, that time that you can play, that time that you can have fun. Like, I think now is like the more serious, like college, your life, you know what I mean?
Since we have a small school, everyone knows each other. Yeah. You know, it's like, everyone knows, like, you know that person, you know, like, from seniors on to the freshmen, seniors on to all the freshmen and everything.
And I was, yeah, like, I was sad because I didn't want to leave. Like, I love high school. And again, I was happy because, like, now I can actually begin my life. I don't have to listen to anyone telling me to do, make all these decisions to go to this route.
After high school, I planned going to Langston University in Oklahoma and study engineering.
I'm going to attend college at Cal State East Bay, CSUN.
I will be attending UC Riverside in the fall.
Along the road, we get tested and we test ourselves and we learn how to deal with certain situations.
I was at graduation sitting down, and I saw my coach crying. He really hit me like, damn, it's over. High school's over.
It doesn't end here, the road continues.
To be honest, my last and final words I would say to my class would be keep in contact with me.
The goal of the fund, or the purpose, is to turn a tragic moment into a triumph. I mean, pretty much, Philip was an intern. You know, he was considered a leader in my eyes. You know, his life got took at an early age, so he wasn't able, you know, to see a lot of stuff. You know what I mean? So the whole, for the future, the future is to take, you know, 4 to 5 interns, 6, to D.C. every year as an inspirational leadership trip. You know, just totally like the... for pretty much a leadership trip, so they can see, I mean, because it's an inspiring place to be. Like, I mean, give you a whole nother outlook on your life.
Shout out to California, going back to Cali in officially 7 days from now, okay?
My name Wale, and I came to get it, came to get it, came to get it. My name Wale. Tight start off 09, kicking in the door, and I'm everybody problem. Stunting at some other Joy Nines, I got Phil Knight talking about, hey, you got them. Let's talk about the cars y'all got. You say you got a lot of whips, but I got a lot. I got the right to be cocky. Get so much good, this jockey's jock me. Mad that you not me. I remain a giant and you Jeremy shock. And if you ain't heard me properly, if you speak garbage, then we know copies. DC chillin', PG chillin', blow it to the ceiling, stuntin' in my billionaire. Here on my billionaire friends, that's money on my mind. Wale.
Yes, first time.
Yeah, it was my first time flying.
And then, you know, we take off. Start moving. The plane starts moving.
I felt so cool. Cause it felt like we wasn't doing nothing at first, and then when the plane started going, like it started taking off, it was like
kind of getting nervous because I hear the big deal about turbulence. I'm like, oh gosh, what is this? What's turbulence?
You look out the window, the plane's gonna fall apart because like the wings is shaking too much.
The lady, she was like, turbulence. I remember she was like, turbulence is the pilots, as potholes at the drivers. I was like, I was like, hey, we got some pretty bad pothole, you know, you pop a tire on the pothole.
Like, it was scary when you get in the sky, though, because, like, they got turbulence, and, like, the plane, like, it's like speed bumps in the car.
Yeah, so we start taking off, the plane starts shaking. I'm like, oh my gosh, just looking back and forth, but everybody's all calm. I'm like, you don't feel the plane shaking, it's like vibrating in the air, just. In the end, turbulence is the exciting part. After that, it's very boring. Oh, when I first walked out, my first impression was, man,
it's hot. It's hecka hot. And there ain't no sun. It was humid. It was like, it was hot. It wasn't dry heat. It was like wet heat. So it was like, it'd just be all sticky and everything. It was just like, it hit you as soon as you walk out the airport. It was like, whoosh, like in your face.
Why is it so hot when the sun is not out?
It was just like, it was almost, it was almost like you felt different. Like I had a different kind of feeling. Like I could, I was just real excited about what was ahead and what was gonna, what we was about to see and what we was about to do.
What you got in store for the boys this week?
A hot bowl of peanuts right now. That's all you eat. Hot bowl of peanuts. Florida style. I think it was the same. This is the closest they've been in the South. Look at that. Hot bowl of peanuts.
The garlic bread. The dinner. That's like a brunch snack. Brunch.
We all eat peanuts. I'm telling you, ain't you made
it. Oh, we had some. I don't know what Gerard be thinking about, but he...
Gerard thought it'd be a great idea to boil some peanuts. He made boiled peanuts. He said they were going to be the best thing I ever tasted in my life, but the only thing he did was make the peanuts soggy and more salty than they really were.
It's, a delicacy in Florida, and it was made in Florida in Gerard, which...
Well, they don't know nothing about them boiled peanuts. I tried to tell them, yeah, but it took like, that was the first time I actually took the boiled peanuts. And that's a big thing in deep south, like especially Florida, Georgia. So I told them we're going to do these boiled peanuts. And they came out good. It just took like 2 days to cook them.
Boiled peanuts. Just like it sounds. It's disgusting. It feels nasty. So Gerard tried to make some boiled peanuts against somebody's recipe he tried to use, but he ended up throwing a little too much Gerard into the recipe.
They couldn't keep their hands off it.
The boiled peanuts was like, it was weird. It was like I never heard anybody boiling peanuts.
What they said?
I mean, they were different. It's something that, yeah, they were good and they were different. Never had them before. Man, dog, we up, man. You see what time it is, man. We out here. We done made it. We up all night.
They go Terry. Fresh off the plane.
They go Terry looking dark.
A couple hours ago.
We can't see you, Terry. You too dark, man. We just hear your voice. Man, we got Gerard over here. Gerard over here still up, man. Thugging it. Miguel over there. Say what's up to the camera.
Say it, Gerard. Hey. Sherwood Entertainment.
Hey, Sherwood Entertainment. We got Jamar right here, cocaine on the phone, but it's good, though, man. It's good.
It was Sherwood ESPK out, you know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying?
The only reason you can see him is the TV light on.
The TV right there. You know what he watching, man.
You know what I'm saying?
He watching that robot chicken. That kind of look, that don't look right. His face is too close to that little robot
chicken. Man, we got Roland over there, man. You see Ro, man. Let's wake this thing up for these boys up in here, man. Wake this thing up. Yeah. We got Barry, man. Barry the cameraman. You see me. You see it happening, man. This is all. This is all. Step into the light. You got to see me, man. It's real time right here, man. We doing this thing, man. We out here.
What's up, Baltimore?
Man, what's up, Baltimore? Where we at?
What's up? We in Baltimore, D.C. right now.
Man, thank you, man. What's happening? What's happening?
Maryland.
You're in Maryland.
No, we're in D.C., Washington.
You're in Baltimore, D.C.
Kick that beat, DJ. DJ over there with the beat. Finna hit it. That's it.
I came out of subway tunnel. I was like,
how did they fit all of these beautiful, like, monument in this small city.
So much nicer than Oakland. Oakland, like, it took a dump on Oakland.
If we didn't make that tour, if we wouldn't have pointed everything out, I would have not known what some of the buildings were, like the Treasury or the Federal Building or anything. I would have not known what that was. I thought it was like a regular building or an old post office. I didn't think that was behind us. Like, we got on, I didn't know that was there.
I don't know if anybody who never been to D.C., it's just like when you there, to me it just seemed like you're thankful.
The tour guide, our tour guide, I liked him a lot. He was kind of different, but he knew what he was talking about. Like, it seemed like he had been living in Washington his whole life. He went to college to study natural history or something like that. Because let's see, where did we first go? When we first got on tour bus, we went to the U.S. Capitol building. Before we got there, we were driving down some long street, and either way you look, there's history, there's important things everywhere. Like, if you look over here, you have to take pictures, but then you're like, oh wow, I don't want to miss this over here. And the whole time I'm driving, he's talking, he's telling us everything. I feel is everything you need to know about this building, or everything you need to know about that building.
Capitol Hill was like the start off to a great day. We got there, and it was just like, you see his face on the back of, like, money. Like, you there, and like just going there and then listening to, like, getting the story about, you know, how Capitol Hill actually got into the new building, because before it was just a small building in the back. And the best part about Capitol Hill and me, and I don't know if people even notice about the lady that's on top of Capitol Hill, who is Freedom. Like, she is, I think Freedom overlooks the whole country.
What was the most? I love the Silent Water Stars. Well, the stars, it's like, that was so beautiful.
Americans, most of them men, young men, 18, some under, some lied about their age.
The stars represented, I think, all the each star represented about 1,000 soldiers that died. And it was like, I think it was about 1,000 stars on the wall, just alone. Then they had the water. It was like the whole place was like loud and everything, but there it was like silent, and the water was like steel water. It was steel water, and like that star.
My favorite memorial out of all the memorials had to be Thomas Jefferson. This is my favorite. It was my favorite because it was so simple. Like, it wasn't that much going on, but yet, to me, it moved me. Like, as soon as you walk in, okay, let me explain this straight how it was. So it's set up like a dome at the top. And then underneath the dome, there's all the columns that just represent democracy surrounding it. And then right in the middle, there's Thomas Jefferson just standing strong, staring off into the distance.
I think everybody liked that one. We took some powerful pictures there. Some powerful pictures.
So we took like 30 pictures, and Gerard was having the time of his life taking pictures.
Yeah. A story about Jefferson Morey, I believe the president was it Roosevelt? Roosevelt was the president, and he, when he was in the White House, he wanted the Jefferson Memorial to be, like, soon when he wanted it to be directly out, so when he opened up his window, I forgot the angle, but he wanted to be able to see Thomas Jefferson.
FDR. The FDR Memorial was the most different. Like, usually, it would be something big or maybe like a room or a wall. But FDR, he had 7 different rooms, I think. And so, when you first get there, you see FDR sitting in a wheelchair. And then there's the waterfalls, which represents something. And then you can walk, and then you walk around the corner into another room. And the reason it's there is probably because FDR spent a lot of time right here, or this probably held some importance on FDR's heart or something.
It was so much detail work, like wrinkles in the people's pants and stuff, and like their facial expressions.
Lincoln Memorial was cool because we got to like go in the columns, like to into where Lincoln is sitting.
I think that might have been the busiest place we went to. might have been the busiest monument memorial event for everybody.
I think I was walking next to Jamal and Gerard, and I had my shoes untied. I saw it untied. I reached down, I started tying my shoe. When I got done, I looked, I stopped and I looked, and then right there, you could see MLK.
I think Terry called this old man was look this way, Martin King stood. And it was crazy because you could barely see it, but it was actually right there. And he stood and gave the I Have a Dream speech.
Yes, it had an engraved writing of where Dr. King stood, and I actually got to stand there. It felt good. I was going to give a speech.
I looked out and I saw the Washington Monument and the lake, and it makes you feel good. Then it makes you feel kind of bad because this is all we got to dedicate to this man.
Oh man, Pentagon! Don't play with the Pentagon. If you go to the Pentagon, don't play.
At the Pentagon, I don't know. They got invisible police cars at the Pentagon.
We come down this road, it's a road that goes all around the Pentagon.
So we stop to take photos.
We gonna have fun right here, pose in front of it. Make it seem like we holding it up or something like that.
There's no cars around us. None in sight. No police. No cars. Nobody moving.
And I don't know where this guy came from or where these guys came from, but it seemed like they came from out the sky.
Vari snapped one picture of the Pentagon with the digital camera, or it was disposable. I don't really remember. But as soon as he did that, you hear, woo!
Three cars, cop cars, pulled up on us and was getting ready to shoot us.
And then it's police car right next to us. And nobody knows where the police car came from. It dropped out of the sky or something because it wasn't there when we pulled up.
I didn't know that the pictures was such a big deal. So I'm thinking I need to put my seatbelt on.
They ain't have no signs or nothing. They ain't have nothing.
Yelling, no pictures. Don't put the camera up.
And we didn't hear it coming or nothing like that. He was just there. He was like, you can't take pictures of the Pentagon or anything like that. You guys got to get up out of here. And blah, 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 blah. It made it seem like he was going to, shoot us or something, or blow us up. They thought we was terrorists. And then, right after that, on the way out of the Pentagon, we was leaving, and then some Arabic guys were, they was parked right there at the Pentagon, right in front of us. And then they got out of their car, and they walked up to us, and we're like, oh my gosh, I hope they aren't really terrorists. I don't know, we was being stereotypical, we was like, oh my God, I hope they aren't terrorists or something like that. Because then it's going to we are terrorists because we're talking to them. And then they just end up asking us for a map because they didn't know how to get to, they were trying to get to the Capitol building. And they didn't know how to get there. And then it was like, oh, wouldn't it be some stuff? They went and blew up the Capitol building the next day. But yeah, that was the Pentagon. And then we just got up out of there because we didn't want no more trouble.
Says, welcome to Arlington National Cemetery, our nation's most
sacred shrine.
Please conduct yourselves with dignity and respect at all times. Please remember that that these are hallowed ground.
Arlington was probably the saddest part of the whole trip.
But I was man, it made me realize that it's sad. It was the only thing war really brings is death.
You just drove around in a whole cemetery, and all you see is just rows of white crosses everywhere.
That was that was harder. Inside, I felt all these people just died, just for us though, They gave their lives for so we can have a life, so we can breathe, and we can live the American dream. But it was hard, like, because you just seen rows and rows and rows of just, like, just dead bodies, like, and, I don't know, it was hard. I was touched. It was a happy moment, like, to be able to witness this and say I've been here, but it was hard.
To my unsold soldier, that was the first place. When they say Washington, D.C., that was the first place I wanted to go. I thought that like, they had like found the person, whoever he was, and find out his name and everything, but I know still unknown, like they have not found who he was, his name, or anything.
Something I would like to say to all the people who donated and contributed, first and foremost, I would like to say thank you and really express my gratitude, because I will be forever gracious. You helped give me the opportunity to go out and experience a whole new coast, a whole new part of the U.S. of A.
We thank you greatly. Like, this experience has, like, it helps. Like, you need that chance to get away. Like, it humbles you, like, in a way. Like, it just, I don't know how to say it, but it's here. It's here.
I want to say thank you so much, because it was a life-changing experience and I really enjoy it, and I hope I get to go back next year as like a chaperone or something.
Here, look at the camera for this. Thank you. Best experience of my life, I believe. My life isn't over, so right now it is. And I'm telling you, I want to go back. I think I'm going to like try to go back again in the future sometime. I might, like, in college, I might go back. I'm gonna try, but I want to go back. Like, super bad. I need you.
Thank you, everybody who donated in honor and in loving memory of Philip. You know, this whole trip was like in memory of Philip, and I just want to say thank you, really, and hopefully, you know, in the near future, you can keep donating and we can keep taking youth and just keep trying to inspire these kids, because they need it. They need to see something different in California. They need to see something different in Oakland. They need to go out of the state and go. D.C. is the perfect place to go for a leadership and inspirational trip.
Hey, let me kick it to you right quick, partner. Not as a gangster, as a grown man. What matters more than the mistakes you make is what you're able to learn from them. Big Phil, it's for you, pimpin'.
To a group of suckers who get their hate on. Damn. You won't buy, they get wrong. You reply, then things get blown. Way out of proportion, way bad discussion. Just you against them, pick one in Russia. Maybe you'll get jumped, yeah, that's next. So, they don't want to stop them, yeah, they bustin'. Now you gushing. I'm a land rusher, you to the hospital with a bad concussion. Pleasure hit full time with a hit.